Hey there. Hey, Elaine, how's it going? Hey, Kelly. Hey, Christy. How's it going? How's your night? Luann, thanks. I'd never heard of this artist before. It was shown to me today, actually. Hey, Mandy. So, let's see here. So, I was thinking, like, I need to do another live stream. I haven't done one in a while. What am I going to talk about tonight? And I never plan anything that I talk about unless it's a class. Obviously, I teach on the subject matter of what I advertise that I'm going to teach on. But, hey, Pilar. Hey, Xander. So I just kind of put it out there to spirit, like, okay, inspire me, because that's kind of what I run off of is inspiration from spirit. And they always kind of come through, even if it's in the, you know, in the ninth inning or in the 11th hour or whatever, they always, that idea, that brilliance from spirit, that impression always comes through. So I'd put it out there, and what they inspired me to talk about tonight is actually my lineage in my mediumship. And what I mean by that is, when I say lineage, I don't mean, you know, that my grandmother was a psychic and my great-grandmother was a psychic. That's not what I mean, because sometimes you'll hear people say that they're like a seventh generation psychic, and that's kind of my thoughts on that. I think people get really liberal with their interpretation of what being generational means with that. What I mean is the lineage of my teachers, my mentors, and where they came from. So I started, when did I start working? I started working in 2006, 2007. And it was, and some of you know the story if you've heard me on the radio or whatever, or have come to any of my lectures and stuff like that. But I started in a psychic fair. I was 16, I believe, almost 17. I was 16, went to a psychic fair, had a reading that kind of altered my path, and eventually I started reading at those same psychic fairs. And what happened was two local women from where I grew up kind of took me under their wing, and they weren't, I don't think, teachers in the traditional sense that we think of teachers. They were teachers in the sense of exposing me to things, taking me places. You know, they would take me to psychic fairs, or they were the ones who took me to, like, my first metaphysical expo, the ULE in Columbus, way back when Ken Harsh ran and operated it. And so we would go down there every year, and that's sort of where I got my start. So I used to come to these fairs, and I would always, just because I like being in the energy, I like being around like-minded people, so I would come early, and I would help set up, and I'd stay late, and I'd help take down. And eventually one day the person who put on these fairs said, you know, one of our readers is sick or can't come or whatever, can you fill in? And that's how I got started reading at those psychic fairs. So that was like sort of my introduction into reading. But the first actual class that I think, like an official class that I ever took, was in 2007 with, hey Ted, 2007 with Rita Martin from Berlin Heights, who in this area, she was really well known, and probably nationally in the hypnotherapy field, but probably not a name that you've heard of, but was kind of a big deal around here, a very established presence. And so I went with the intention of taking a class in mediumship, and I think that day we learned every single thing in that class under the sun, from palmistry to card reading to whatever, but we never got spirit communication. So I was hungry for more because I was having these experiences. I needed explanations. And, you know, obviously most people know me or kind of how I got started in this as a career was the Psychic Kids television show with A&E. And that's really where I encountered my very first teacher, one of the few people that I actually consider a teacher, a personal teacher. So I did the Psychic Kids show in 2008, and one of the primary focuses on that show was we worked a missing persons case. So they brought in a forensic medium from my state, from the Toledo area, even though we were kind of filming down in Circleville, sort of near Columbus. And I don't think the producers know this, because on film, it looks like when I met Gail was in that moment that they were filming. And it's true that it was actually the first time that I'd met her, but it was not the first time that I'd spoken to her. When the producers reached out to her and asked her if she was going to be interested in participating in this television show, she contacted me because she didn't want to waste her time with something that was going to be ridiculous, and she wanted to see if I actually had any talent worth investigating. So what she did was she emailed me a photograph after we talked very briefly on the phone of a missing person. And she said, here's a photograph, here's a first name, call me back in 30 minutes, tell me what you get. You know, I want to know, is this person dead or alive? Are they buried? Whatever you can pick up from this, this is what I want you to do. So I did. And she ended up agreeing to do the show. So we met for the first time while we were working that missing case. And one of the things that was really disappointing about television is obviously television is edited for time. You have a week of filming or whatever, and they have to boil down hours and hours and hours and hours of footage to 45 to 48 minutes to fit into an episode. So the majority of the things that came through for that missing persons case was not allowed, or either was not shown or was not allowed to be shown because of it still being an open investigation. And there was a few things that were sort of unusual that I picked up on. And Gail had knowledge of this case prior and had done some work on this case prior. So she knew that some of the things that I saw that I was describing, there was no way I would have known because it wasn't made available to the public, or there were impressions that she also had but had not shared with people. So after that, she asked me if I would be interested in taking me, or kind of, you know, being under her wing. And Gail had kind of had her own platform, her own standing. She's been doing this work for forever. She grew up as a spiritualist in the spiritualist church, and so did her parent, well, her mother. And I believe her grandparents as well were part of the spiritualist church. So what she did in my part of the journey, not only in exposing me to the forensic aspect, but she introduced me to spiritualism, which I am forever grateful and forever indebted to her for, because it's become a huge, huge part of my life. I keep seeing this Shane commenting. The best way to get a hold of me or explain your situation is to just email me at either what you've already done, or to my email, travispsychic@yahoo.com. I'm not exactly sure what it's about, but I will get to it. I'll look at it tonight. I'm probably not going to call anybody tonight. I'm sorry. But anyways, so she sort of introduced me to spiritualism. And as I said, she'd been doing missing persons work for years. She's successfully located missing persons bodies, had done Larry King. So I thought, you know, this is someone who would be really good for me, my journey in that sense. And the other thing too that I think Gail really did to me was she helped pound out the bright and shiny New Agey stuff, because up until that point, I had no official training, I had no official classes, and as much as it kills me to admit it, I was incredibly New Agey at some point. And she kind of beat that out of me in a way that I thought she was being tough on me at the time, but she was right, and it's how it needed to be, and I think that I'm good at what I do today because she was tough on me. And even though I don't talk to her as frequently as I used to, I don't see her as frequently as I used to, she's still tough on me. And she's one of the few people who can, like, get right to, because I'm a very guarded person, she's one of the very few people who can, like, get right to my core and sort of expose my vulnerabilities, but then build me back up. So, Gail, interestingly, also exposed me to the world of trance mediumship, which is not something that I speak a lot of, and it's not something that I do a lot of, but it was under her guidance that I started exploring that. Gail was, she doesn't do much of it anymore, but is a brilliant trance medium. And some of my favorite psychic memories were some of the things that I experienced in listening to her trance sittings and communication with spirit via her body as an instrument. And then some of my own experiences later on as she kind of coached me and guided me in the trance process. So that was also something that is an invaluable thing that I will always carry with me. So something that I don't advertise much anymore is literally like 2 days after filming Psychic Kids, I went to, and I hate that this is even gonna be out there, I went to Hawaii for like 2 weeks, and I did a week-long class with Doreen Virtue, because as I said at the time, I was like a bright and shiny, new agey, fluffy kind of teenager who was just excited about everything, you know, seemingly supernatural. And yeah, so I know there's a lot of controversy around her, one, both being incredibly fluffy, and then two, her conversion to being born again and sort of denouncing the New Age and all that sort of stuff. But I will say this, I did learn skills in that class that helped me as a reader, how to, even though I don't believe at this point that I was talking to angels, like a lot of those people, like a lot of her people do, it still gave me a structure of, okay, how do you do a relationship reading versus how do you do, you know, a health reading versus how you work from a different vibration when you do mediumship. So regardless of whether she's a fraud or a phony or a hypocrite or whatever, and even though I don't really resonate with her work or her teachings, I was able to take things of value out of that. So in some respect there, she, even though it was an impersonal connection, because in a class like that, it's like a class of 500 people, you don't get a lot of one-on-one time. It's not like I know her well, it's not like she was ever on my speed dial, but in a very impersonal way, she did have an impact on my journey. Showed me also to what I didn't want to be. So in a way, I guess you could kind of say she was a teacher too. So very shortly after Hawaii, I came back, and I think it was the following year, I believe, maybe not even a year later, maybe it was later on that year, I started learning from Sharon Klingler, who I mentioned periodically. You know, Sharon's the author of Life with Spirit. She's also the author of Power Words through Hay House, and she's an incredibly talented medium who I have a ton of respect for. Even though their personalities are very different, the one thing that I will say about Sharon is that as a person, she's incredibly sweet and loving. As a teacher, she's tough. but it's a tough love as well. So I think that they kind of have that in common. And again, it's part of why I think that I do what I do and why I'm decent at what I do. So, Sharon, I know, you know, I don't know at what point she became involved with spiritualism. I know that both her and her sister, Sandy, her twin sister, Sandy, Sandra Ann Taylor, were brought up Catholic, I believe. But I know that they'd been going to Lilydale for a long time, or at least Sharon had. I'm not exactly sure what her personal teachers or lineages and stuff is like that. But I did my first class with her, I think, like I said, in 08, late 08 or early 09, and it was a weekend course in Cincinnati, and I was kind of hooked. The thing I like about Sharon is she's not conventional in her methodologies. She's always looking for more abstract or more unique or more non-traditional ways to communicate with spirit. And I got a lot out of those classes. So I just continued doing classes with her whenever I could or whenever I was able to. And one of the most important investments I think that I ever made to my mediumship was a week-long class with her in Cleveland that was, I think it was called Advanced Spirit Linking and Public Mediumship Intensive. So in that course, it was literally just a week long of grooming you for platform work, for sort of like audience, what we would call more in the mainstream, what we would call gallery readings, but in spiritualism we would call platform work or platform demonstrations. And I got a lot out of that. It was long days. It was, like I said, it was a week long. And she's tough on you, but I got so much out of it. My confidence just boosted when I did that class. Since then, you know, in addition to that, I know I always harp on sitting in a circle and your own personal practice, because it doesn't matter how many classes you take, if you don't continue to sit for spirit, your mediumship is never going to really develop worth a damn. So I've done other classes since then, but as always, you gotta find a circle, or at least you have to sit for spirit every day on your own with the intention, to build that power. You know, so one of the places, you know, I mentioned Lilydale, Camp Chesterfield in Indiana also has a wonderful program. I've not had the chance to do a lot of the classes there yet, but last February I did do a clairvoyant intensive weekend, and that was really great. And, you know, it's just good to be in the energy of other people. And they're just really wonderful, down-to-earth people. And I think too, the clairvoyant weekend, I believe, is usually in February, but that's great for beginners also. So different levels of experience can engage in that, but it's a great place for beginners to feel safe and to feel comfortable. Repeat Sharon's last name. It's Sharon Klingler, Klingler. And Sharon has her own website, Sandy has her own website, then they have one together because sometimes they teach and demonstrate together. Also, right outside of Lilydale is Fellowships of the Spirit. I've done some classes there as well. I know the one class that I did was a class in mediumistic trance states with Neil Rybzowski, which was wonderful. He's just a fantastic guy. I believe he's the president now at Lilydale. And that was a really great class too, because I'd been a little rusty in trance, and it was nice to see too how other people teach and instruct and their philosophies around trance development. So that was pretty good as well. And they have wonderful stuff. And the thing too that I love about fellowships is that they have offered a lot of their classes on what's the word I'm looking for? Like live streaming. So if you can't travel, or if you're on the other side of the world or the other side of the country, you can pay for the class and you can do it via computer. So there's that. Some other people that I've also done some classes with, not that I would necessarily consider them teachers per se, like some of the others, but I've done some classes with here and there. One is Jake Smoyedny. And I will spell his last name for you because it's doozy, Samoyedny, but he's known as the Compassionate Medium. This was his first book, just called The Compassionate Medium, and I really liked him. He if you saw him on the street, you would not expect him to be a medium. He almost looks, I believe he's Italian. He's kind of got that New Yorker kind of accent thing going on. He looks more like he stepped out of The Sopranos versus, you know, a spiritualist church. But he's just fantastic. He's so down to earth, and he truly is compassionate. And I agree with so many. He's very grounded and practical in his approach, which I always appreciate because, as I said, I think a lot of people tend to get caught up in the fluff. And then another medium that I've done some courses with is Lisa Williams, who some of you may remember from her show on Lifetime. Her show was called Life Among the Dead, and her first book was titled the same thing, Life Among the Dead. And she's written several books, and I think has a card deck and everything else like that. But I'd watched her on television and stuff, and then the very first time I went to Lilydale, I got to meet her very briefly. And then I've done one or two classes, I can't remember. I honestly don't know Lisa well on a personal level. I've met her a small handful of times, but I will say I do think that she's a good medium, and I do think that she is bringing a life, a livelihood to Lilydale that hasn't been there in some time. So it's good. I think it's a good thing. It's a needed change. There seems to be a lot of needed change coming there, so I'm excited about that. So that is some of my history. In addition to that, I have been sitting in circle for nearly 5 years. I had a group that sat for mental mediumship development every Tuesday, and then for about almost 2 years now, I had a group. It's kind of evolved. Some of the members have shifted and changed over time that sit for the development of physical phenomena. Though I'm not exactly sure the future of said circle, but regardless of what happens, and even after sort of the disbanding of the group that sat for mental for so many years, I still sit for spirit every single day. Or nearly every single day. Usually if I do readings, I won't sit that day. It's on my off days. But even if it's just for 5-10 minutes, you know, I think it's important to have that dedication and to invest in yourself to see your mediumship go anywhere. You know, sitting in that power, building that power, connecting with spirit, that's the fuel in the gas tank of your mediumship. And without that, the car of your mediumship is going to go nowhere. So, hopefully, if you're interested, some of those resources or teachers may be a good thing for you to look into. And I always recommend, you know, finding a metaphysical center or a spiritualist church and seeing if they have an open circle that you can try. And if that resonates with you, then they may have some closed circles that you could join as well for your development. But now that I've talked about what I'm going to talk about, I'm just going to look through here and see what kind of questions you guys have. Ted, I had a client ask me if I do oracle readings, but I do not buy into those. Yeah, well, I mean, I think you can read anything. It's the interpreting energy. It just kind of frustrates me when I see people who can't work without a tool. Like, at that point, it's a crutch. So, you know, it's personally, like, not for me. I know some people love their angel cards and some people love their tarot cards, and it's fun to do. I have those things. I play with them for myself, but I just personally don't feel like it has any place in my work. Hey, Drucifer. Shane, yes, I do believe in reincarnation, but I don't believe in maybe an interpretation that's as literal as a lot of people think, or as maybe not literal is not the right word, maybe as linear as a lot of people think. Interested in reading some of those books. Yeah, this one especially, The Compassionate Medium, he just, there's just a beautiful, there's beautiful philosophy that is brought through in these books, but there's also information and perspectives on mediumship that I think it's important for people to hear. So this isn't just a book if you're a medium. It's also if you've lost a loved one, if you're on a spiritual journey, if you are just looking for something to do and you want entertainment. It's accessible to everyone. It's not geared towards one specific person, even though it's called, you know, the most important book on mediums and mediumship. It's applicable to, I think, anyone who's in touch with their own spirit. So, now that I've gone over that, do you guys have any questions? Either related or non-related. Luann, were you able to get those titles, or do you need me to repeat them? See and converse with souls, but I find they often speak in parables at first. Have you experienced this? I wouldn't necessarily say I've experienced it in parables. I think that it takes a while to learn your language of symbolism, of what means what, you know, for you, your sort of your shorthand with spirit. So symbol, metaphor, absolutely. The other thing too, while you guys are thinking if you have any questions, is I do have two services that I offer that I don't really push, or I don't really advertise a lot, you know, because most people, 99.999% of what people contact me for is either to get some sort of psychic insight into their life or to connect and communicate with their loved ones that have passed over. The one thing that I do offer is spiritual healing. And it seems like, and it comes and goes in waves, but healing kind of moves in and out of popularity every few years or so. And I've seen recently on TLC, they have this new show, The Healer, which I think is fantastic that's kind of coming out. But I want to explain a little bit about my healing process as well. So first and foremost, I make no claims to cure, fix. Healing to me is improvement. That can be physical, mental, emotional, or spiritual. There's some sort of an improvement. It doesn't mean that, as I've said, I'm not a genie. I can't wave a magic wand over you and fix your problems. Like a lot of people, my journey into healing actually started with Reiki when I was in high school, learning Reiki. So for those of you who don't know, Reiki is a Japanese originated style of hands-on healing or energy medicine. Legally though, because it's become more popular and then laws get in the way, we can't technically say it's a form of healing. We have to say it's a form of relaxation that may have a side effect of healing, but it's essentially energy work, bringing through universal energy to improve, balance, harmonize the body, mind, or spirit. So I did that for a few years. I did Reiki 1, 2, 3, and then moved to, you know, that master level and started teaching other people. But something that I think a lot of people experience when they start on a healing path is that they may start with a specific modality, but eventually it kind of blends into their own flavor or their own signature. So after a while, it just kind of becomes what it is, and maybe not strictly, you know, Reiki, or maybe not strictly quantum touch or pranic healing, or, you know, whatever it may have started in. But that's not always what I do now. So the way that I work is very much what you see in the spiritual churches or at places like Lilydale or Chesterfield or whatever. So I may, and each person is different. If someone comes to me for healing, I never know what it's going to look like. Sometimes it may be more what they might call magnetic healing, where it's just more of a, your own, you know, manipulating with your own energy. Sometimes it's more of that universal energy. But a lot of times what happens is I blend with spirit to bring through healing. And that's more of that spiritualist approach. And I'm actually, in February, I'm going to be doing a afternoon workshop on how we do that, how we link with spirit healers or spirit doctors and let them blend in our auric field to channel or impart healing to other people. So that's what happens. Sometimes when someone's on my table, I may have one of my own spirit helpers who kind of brings through that healing energy, or it may be a spirit that's unique to the person on the table, and it's just, you know, that's the one and only time I meet that particular helper, which is confusing sometimes, because each time I'm like, oh, is this a new, like, helper? Is this a new guide? And then the person leaves, and I realize it was just part of their team, or like a specialist, so to speak, who came in for that. And like I said, sometimes it does feel more like the Reiki, and sometimes it is just more of a manipulation of energy. So I just kind of leave it open to whatever spirit inspires or whatever that person needs. So, you know, in person, I'm obviously I'm based in Northern Ohio, so I can do that in person if you're interested in any sort of spiritual healing or energy work. But the other thing too that I don't really talk about that I offer, but I don't push as much, is I do coaching and personal development. So people can either book hour-long sessions, or I offer a package for five one-hour personalized coaching sessions for $350, which when you take into account that normally a half hour of my time is $75 and you are getting 5 hours of my time for $350, you know, it's not a bad price. Not that what I do is about money, but I get compensated for my time, as anyone does. But the thing about that is the first initial contact we have is talking about where you're at, what you want to get out of the sessions. For some people, they want to maybe build relationships with spirit guides, or they want to open their channels, or they want to, you know, focus more on spirit communication, or they want to learn how to focus the mind better for meditation or whatever it is. But, you know, they sort of tell me, this is why I've gotten a hold of you. This is what I want to work on. And so I also kind of do a little bit of an intuitive evaluation as well, and maybe give a little messages. But the rest of those sessions, the rest of that time is focused on, I put together like a syllabus of, okay, so for the next 4 or 4.5 sessions, we're going to do this on this day, this on this day, this on this day. And it's loose, obviously, because you have to leave room for that spirit inspiration. But then we work on their goals, and a lot of it is just practical exercises, coaching you through practical exercises. I'm not going to get you on the phone or get you on Skype or get you into my office and then talk at you things that you could read about in a book. I want to take you through it. And then I want to watch your energy while you're going through it, so I know where you're getting caught up or where you're being successful, so I could help you continue to be successful. So that's something that I offer, and that is something too. It doesn't matter where in the world you live, because of Skype or, you know, telephone or whatever. I've been very blessed and fortunate that I've had clients in the Ukraine and Ireland and Kenya and Australia and Canada, and I've had some in Germany. You know, it's the world is not a big place at all, and there's always a way around seeming obstacles. So, you know, if the healing is something that you're interested in, or if the coaching is something that you're interested in, that is something that I do offer, and information's on my website about that. But if you want more information, you can always just get a hold of me. Let's see here. Alexander, is sitting in spirit like meditation? Yeah, essentially. So different people have different interpretations of sitting for spirit, or what sitting in the power means. And when I say I'm sitting for spirit, it means that I am sitting in awareness of my own divinity, but the divine nature that links all things together, whether you want to call that God, source, the universe, spirit, with a capital S, you know, whatever. So different people do that differently. For me, it usually involves, you know, seeing that spark of the divine that exists within me and letting that light shine and blending with the higher source, or seeing myself, visualizing myself blending with the higher light, moving upward. The visualization itself doesn't matter. It's more about feeling and recognizing that divinity or that spirit around you, and inviting spirit, come close, draw close, be with me. And outside of that, just sitting in that energy, sitting in the presence of the spirit world, sitting in awareness of a higher power without an agenda to necessarily get a message or whatever. Although usually after a while of sitting in the power, I'll say, okay, spirit, is there anything that I need to know before I sort of bring myself back? But so essentially, yeah, meditation. Mandy, your thoughts on Sylvia Brown? I think she was great at spirituality, but not so much psychic. God bless poor dead Sylvia. Sylvia, once upon a time as a teenager, I thought that bitch walked on water. And then I got older and I'm like, wow, she's not only inaccurate, but she's grumpy. She's not very nice to people. But here's the thing. Sylvia, I believe at one time, probably very early on, early 90s, had something. Now, was she ever a fantastic psychic? No. Did she have something? I believe so. But after a while, I think it became more about either books or talk show appearances, and she lost her compassion. She lost her compassion with people, and I think that just kind of squashed any ability that she had. And at that point, you're so immersed in it, it's like you just keep up the dog and pony show. So I do give Sylvia credit in the way that she brought psychic to the mainstream. You know, there's those early pioneers, Sylvia, and then a little bit later you had Van Praagh and Edward, and some people think she was a saint and other people say she was, you know, a felon. But in that way, I have my respect for poor dead Sylvia Brown. And I don't know, I can just kind of like see her on the other side, like chewing on her fingernails, talking to Francine. But yeah, it kind of cracks me up now, but it's not funny. It's kind of sad, actually, but she was a trip. Helene, do you have to be physically present for you to do the healing or the coaching? I'm in Cincinnati. I've had a reading with you on the phone. The coaching, nope. We can work by Skype or telephone. The healing. Now, in the same way, because everything's energy, you don't need to be physically present for the healing. As of now, I have only offered the energy work or the healing in person because I haven't quite gotten to the point of how I want to offer it or what that format's going to look like. Because, you know, for all anybody knows, you know, when you come into the store, you come into the healing room, you're on the table for an hour. You know, you feel what I'm feeling, you hear me in the room, we're present together. You know how much time I'm there, you know what I'm doing, you know the areas of your body that I'm focusing on. You know, I haven't quite figured out how I want to offer remote or distance healing sessions that make it seem like people are actually getting what they pay for. Because for all anybody knows, you know, they're paying for something and I'm like, oh yeah, I sent the healing. So, you know, I kind of have to figure out, am I going to write up some sort of report of what I found or what I felt? You know, do I sit down for that same amount of time, that hour, and just do constant healing? Or do I send, you know, 10 minutes here and 10 minutes there? I haven't quite figured that out yet. So, as of now, I've just done the healing in person, but I'm still kind of working on what I want that to look like for the future. Bev, as a person who has had one-on-one coaching with Travis, all my sessions were awesome. I learned so much about myself. I was able to receive healing in certain areas of my life and came away with an enormous amount of knowledge. Well, thank you, Bev. I'm glad that it was a good investment for you. I feel like I missed something. I apologize if I've missed something. Sounds like I have to take a road trip. Helena, too, it's like, you know, as I said before, I never know what the result or what the outcome is going to be. You know, if someone's coming and they have, you know, severe, I'm just using this as an example. I don't know anything about your health or wellness or anything like that. But like, if someone has severe arthritis and they think an hour session is going to make a huge impact, probably not. Not that I want to ever limit what spirit's capable of, but you know, there's lots of things I think to take into consideration when it comes to seeking a healer or seeking healing. So is there anything else before I hop off here? Also, I did want to let you guys know, my phone sessions for this month are booking up pretty nicely, but I do have some availability for in-person sessions. So if you're local, I do have a little bit more of a flexibility this month. Jennifer, just want to say hello and glad you're doing well. Thank you. It's good to see from you, hear from you, see from you. Are there any cures or developments spirit tell you about? I personally have not had that. If you're interested in that sort of stuff, though, you absolutely need to educate yourself about Edgar Cayce. He was probably at his height of prominence in the 1930s, but the most documented, one of the most amazing and talented clairvoyants of the past couple centuries. As far as what he did, there've been a lot, you know, there's so many different avenues of what we do, but even today in Virginia Beach, the ARE, or the Association for Research and Enlightenment, still exists, and literally transcripts of thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands of his readings are there. And the thing with Edgar Cayce is he was often clairvoyant in his awake state, even though he didn't necessarily like that being put out there, but he was sort of a trance. I don't know if maybe trance medium is not the right word, because he wasn't so much bringing spirit through. He channeled his superconscious, what they called the source, but he was more of a trance channel. So he was always in a altered state. A trance state as he was giving his readings. And even today, a lot of open-minded medical people look at the cures and the remedies and the guidance that he gave around health issues. There was even a hospital that came out of the vast amounts, just volumes and volumes of medical information that he gave, which all that information is still out there. So absolutely learn of Edgar Cayce. Would you say you've mastered your own ability to recuperate after an intense session, or does that always vary based on the session? So I have found, oddly enough, I find that a bunch of little sessions drain me more than a couple long sessions. And it's just because getting in and out of someone's vibration, there's always vibrational shifts, and that itself can be very tiring. I tend to find that not much like super drains me anymore as to where before I could, you know, I've built up my stamina over time, but and then there are times too where it's like backwards, where I will feel like shit and I will not want to read for someone and I'm dreading the session, and then I get inside and I get in that mode of being of service, and the things that come through totally give me, like, they check my spirit, checks my attitude at the door, and by the time I leave, not only does the person feel better, but it's like I feel better, I'm in a better mood, I feel energized, and I walk away, I think, with as much of a healing as whatever the other party may have received. But it doesn't mean that I'm still not going to come home and drink a Dr. Pepper and take a bath and ignore people. That's how I recharge my batteries. Helene, I have to hop off. Thank you for another great Facebook Live. It was good to hear from you, Helene. And Lori. Anything else before I hop off here, you guys? I think my nephew is sensitive and school gives him migraines every Monday. Is there any advice to help him prevent them? So, it's tough. Like, kids are tough because, you know, as an adult, if an adult came to me and said, I'm having trouble being overwhelmed, I would be like, you gotta get grounded and you've gotta stop. You gotta stop doing that. Because some part of you is engaging that, is saying yes to taking things on, even if it's not a conscious part of you. You can't say that to a little kid. So it makes it more difficult. I think a lot of times you have to play to the level of where they're at, the level of what they can comprehend. So for example, a lot of people are interested in stones and crystals. And I actually, my beliefs around that have changed and evolved. I don't know quite where I stand. I think they're beautiful. I have a lot of them. I don't know that they're magic, but I think they're beautiful. So even if you did something of like, you know, if you start, here's a rock, here's this stone, this crystal or whatever, and anytime you, this is going to help keep you focused. This is going to help prevent you from feeling too much. This is going to, you know, help you kind of create a buffer. And anytime you feel overwhelmed or whatever, you know, you take that stone or you remember that, or, you know, remember to call on grandma or whatever. I think you have to kind of appeal to where they're at that age. And two, you know, there might be, you know, little kids, but they still have spirit guides and helpers. And they might not know how to talk and communicate with them consciously, but you can even just be like, okay, the guides of little Billy is that, you know, this is his experience. Is there anything, you know, kind of appeal on his behalf to them? Can we make some adjustments? And just kind of see what that does. And watching ratchet TV shows to recharge. Don't forget that. Yes. You know, you have to, after you, have your Dr. Pepper and take your bath, you have to watch The View, and then you have to watch some other sort of, trashy reality TV show. You're funny, Steven. Jill, you know, a lot of people, you know, when it comes to groundedness and deflecting and all that sort of stuff, go to black tourmaline. And they also say it's good for protection. But I think any stone is good for protection if you chuck it up, you know, if you chuck it hard enough at somebody. If you could go back in time and give your younger, sensitive self advice, what would it be? You're not broken. That's probably what it would be. You're not broken, and you'll show those bitches. And that you're safe. Like, I would just be like, you really are okay. Because I never felt like I was okay. I never felt like anything was gonna be okay. All right, guys, I think I'm gonna hop off of here. I appreciate your time. Thank you for listening. If you have any questions about what we talked about, those resources that I mentioned earlier, just shoot me an email. If you're interested in those sessions, just shoot me an email. I try to do my best to get back to people as quickly as possible. Brandy says, as you were first on your journey, did you ironically find yourself around like-minded people? Yes and no. Like, I sought it out. I didn't like magically find these people falling into place, but I sought it out, and there were a lot of synchronicities, and I always know that spirit's at work, or that I'm in alignment with where I'm supposed to be in my life when synchronicity abounds. That to me is the definition of grace, being held in the perfect place at the, you know, the right place, the right time, everything just coincides, those divine synchronicities. That to me is my definition of being held in grace. And I found that at every time I turned myself a little bit more towards my purpose, those synchronicities abounded. For example, I mentioned those two women at the psychic fair who kind of took me under their wing. You know, where I grew up in a town feeling like I was the only person who felt dead people, or I was the only person who saw things or knew things or whatever. It turns out that the woman who read me lived, like, you know, 5 miles away from me in the country where I grew up, and the other woman lived, you know, right in the same town as well. So what it helped me in was making me not feel like I was broken. Or making me not feel, one, not that I was broken, and that there, because there are other people like me, so I didn't feel isolated anymore. I'm finding more spiritualists are around me. Wondered if it was a coincidence, or people are just more aware of open and titling themselves as such. You know, it could be either of those things. One thing I would say is, you know, how are they using the term spiritualism? Do they just mean that they consider themselves a spiritualist person, or are they a spiritualist? But even so, you know, the more, as spiritualists, we work off natural law. We live by natural law. You know, like energies attracting like energies. So I do think that you attract, you know, people always say you attract what you think. Well, I don't think that you attract what you think. Otherwise, there'd be, like, you know, snakes with wings. Because, you know, I think about that, how terrible it would be if there are snakes with wings. So we don't attract what we think, we attract what we are. We attract the similar vibration that we hold now. It's not just thoughts, it's not just feeling, it's not just the body. There's all different facets to consciousness, and we draw things to us, we manifest holistically with all parts of ourselves. So I think it's part of that synchronicity that you're where you need to be. But, okay, you guys, I appreciate it. I've talked long enough. Have a great night.